Marie mentioned, but this is the fourth Sunday in our series on Parker Palmer's book, A Hidden Wholeness. An excellent book that I hope that lots of you will get and read. Have it here with me just. And thank you to Robert Brummett and Yin for bringing this book and this four-week group study to us on Tuesday nights. In week three, Robert shared a parable-type story of a rabbi and a hidden treasure. And it sparked quite the experience in me. And from that story, this analogy was born of the buried treasure. To me, this book is all about the treasure within that we've buried. And discovering it is exactly what we are up to here as a community under Rev Nguyen's leadership. And welcoming it to the surface, this deeper part of ourselves that wants to come out into the light. That, to me, is true freedom. When we feel integrated and whole, free to be ourselves, real, imperfect, complex, fully expressed, whatever that might mean for each of us as individuals. Creating a safe space for that authentic, true self to emerge is at the heart of what this place does for me. Today, I'm happy to get to share about my journey of discovering my spiritual freedom, which is still ongoing, of course. That's the word discovering in my talk title. But I hope that my story, where I once was to where I am now, may help you and inspire you on your own journey. I've gone from a life where I was once, in many ways, closed off, fearful, playing small, to now a place where I feel more open. That's kind of my word. Confident, willing to authentically show up in my life. This is where I'm at in the process of uncovering more of my true self and recognizing my own wholeness. A quote from Thomas Keating: metaphysics and the religions of the world have discovered the insight that human beings are designed for unlimited happiness, the enjoyment of all truth and love without end. This spiritual hunger is part of our nature as beings with a spiritual dimension. Here we are with an unbounded desire for happiness and not the slightest idea of where to look for it. Thomas Keating. Only recently have I become aware that all my life I've been occupied with the notion of freedom. Looking back, that was clearly the treasure that I was seeking. Map making, navigating, strategizing, in search of happiness, in search of freedom. However, I've had kind of a complex relationship with my own freedom and happiness. In fact, I've held myself back from experiencing the fullness that life has to offer in many ways. Growing up, my Aunt Kathy's here. She was one of these too, the good Methodist farm girl. Always doing the right thing. On the surface, I was multi-talented, responsible, helpful, creative, and happy. But under the surface, my shy little heart was confused about some things. I hold no blame. It's nobody's fault that I didn't feel that my own feelings and desires and curiosities were natural and okay to explore. I hold no blame, for example, against my parents for anything that I might have felt confusion or shame around. It was a wonderful, loving, safe, healthy place, that Morgan County farm where I was raised. There were just certain things that never got discussed. One of those topics, for sure, was dating, sex, relationships. I was so shy and yet curious, and trying to find my way in that world as a teen girl was terrifying. While my family was in many ways wonderful, loving, they never got discussed. I'll share two stories now that shaped my understanding as a girl. So the year was 1994. I was 15 years old, and I was going out with the older brother of one of my best friends. I barely knew him. We barely talked, actually. However, he was my boyfriend because my friend came and said, "Hey, I know someone that likes you, and it was her brother, and okay. However, I also had this friend, a fellow band geek, if you will, a total sweetheart, and I was falling for him. So I followed my heart. I broke up with the big brother, and what happened? I lost my entire friend group. For a 15-year-old, that's kind of a big deal. Little sister told all my friends not to talk to me, and they followed her lead. And here I am at the lunch counter, the lunch room, you know, who am I gonna sit with? That whole thing, that's like the most tragic, like teen, to a teen mind and a teen heart. Lesson learned, right? Don't follow your heart. Don't listen to your inner voice. Bad, bad things happen. Everyone abandons you when you do that. That's the lesson that I got. It's not safe. It's not safe. Don't do it. Second story. It's junior prom, 1996. I had an experience of what we'll call an unwanted sexual advance. I look back at pictures that night, and I was hot. I was like, little black dress, 17-year-old, high heels. There was this confidence that I was carrying with me that after this night was over, got tucked far, far away. I mean, that little naive farm girl was absolutely terrified of sex and was afraid of what he was really gonna do if he had overpowered me, which luckily he did not. But that experience shut me down. Lesson learned again, don't dress sexy. Don't be free and confident. Bad things happen, you will be unsafe. In fact, it's best if you don't appear like you're even interested in sex in any way. Cue the baggy brown corduroy pants and the Adidas soccer shirts and the determination to never let any unwanted advance make its way through that stone wall I had built around myself when it came to intimacy, sexuality, and connection. Too scary. I was done. And this is what we do, right? It's human. We do the best we can, but it's scary and it's natural to want to hide. We take away false lessons from painful experiences. My false lesson was that it's not safe to be myself, to follow my heart, or to express certain aspects of who I was. And that became a solid storyline for me. What got buried? My connection with my desire and with being desirable. Desire in general, not just sexual, but for example, stories about money had me bury my desire for prosperity. Stories around service had me giving away my time. And in general, my responsible good girl inside, she felt that she should bury her desire for adventure. The idea that it was even okay to have wants and curiosities, that you can make choices based on what you want to do, what you want to be, have, heard plenty about the generosity and humility of Jesus. Sacrifice, right? The meek shall inherit, etc., etc. My own needs should come last. And to this, add to this that I had a mother who seemed to me back then to embody this selfless generosity so perfectly. This is in here, but I get now that she actually does do self-care and she actually comes from a place of fullness, but at that time, no needs, can't have needs. Okay, so if I saw aspects of selfishness rising up in me, or arrogance, you can bet that I would shut that down and make sure that it was never seen. I also didn't want to take up too much space or shine too brightly and risk casting a shadow on anyone else. This deep underlying fear of shining too bright also had me denying parts of my true self to stay small. As an adult, I became the servant martyr, carrying huge underlying resentment, compulsively seeking to serve and placing myself just underneath someone else, making them my authority figure. I was the super mom, the full-time dedicated employee, the church lady, volunteer, generous neighbor, you name it, with no needs of her own. If my buried treasure was freedom, then my fear was the shovel. Nobody else did this. If it was scary or shameful, it got put in a trunk, along with my sense of wholeness and buried in the sand. Maybe someday, I thought, I'll come back for these, but not now. Maybe someday. And even having done this subconsciously, my conscious mind at the time didn't really realize this was happening, so I'm still frantically scanning, looking for that elusive freedom to be myself. I was in a constant, unsettled, grass will be greener existence, the next right job, the next right relationship, the next right experience. I was going to figure this out up here. I was going to figure it out. And out here in the world. I imagine myself, to go with the analogy still, on my hands and knees, no shovel, nothing, just bare hands crawling around, flinging dirt and sand in the air, barely scratching the surface, but yet still frantically digging away. With that stressed out, striving energy, I made it through, somehow, my young adulthood, grasping and searching, hustling and people-pleasing, burning out, blowing up, melting down, and starting over. Never quite finding what I was looking for. The good girl was tired. Enough was enough. Something had to give. This is from our book. When we understand integrity for what it is, we stop obsessing over codes of conduct and embark on a more demanding journey toward being whole. It's from A Hidden Wholeness by Parker Palmer. In the book, he goes on to quote John Middleton Murray, "For the good person to realize that it is better to be whole than to be good is to enter on a straight and narrow path compared to which his or her previous rectitude was flowery license." Wholeness over goodness. Huh. Intriguing, but I still wasn't quite sure. Sound pretty risky at this point. So, exhausted and having blown up my life once again, in 2012 I came across Unity. Every time I was in a Unity church, mostly in Mid-Missouri actually, at first, I felt peace, I felt safe, I felt familiar somehow. In 2014, I wrote my ABC book. I was struggling, certainly, still in some aspects of my life, but so much growth was also happening with my courage to face those struggles. I found more self-awareness, a return to creativity, and the spark of a belief that maybe my own goals, desires, and happiness were worth some focus and attention, maybe. It was around that time that I found first a friendship and then a working relationship with Rev Bien. My path continued to lead me deeper into this community. Even as I lived almost a 2-hour drive from here, it felt like this was where I was supposed to be. I'd learned enough about listening within to know to trust that pull, like a gravitational force that was drawing me deeper into the connection here at Unity Temple. As mentioned, I'm now the Director of Youth and Family Education, and wow, what an honor. I enjoy so deeply the work that I do, but there was also a part of me that recognized, oops, I did it again, right? I put myself in this service role, this place where you all will be connecting and sharing and growing together up here, and I'll be downstairs with the kids. What a double-edged sword of sorts, right? Amazing to be here and yet separated from the service. Oops. So now what? My now what was the weekly classes and groups. I found my church experience in the Tuesday night classes offered here through the Youth Thrive program. Topics varied, always interesting, right? And fresh and new, it's Unity, all right? I already knew this. This place is different. But oh man, when Rev Nien launched her, who remembers this, taboo topics? Sex, money, and relationships. And I'm supposed to like co-teach this, like how is this? Like not co-teach that, but like develop curriculum for the youth. And I just like, what is happening? This is my stuff, right? These are my biggies, these are my no-nos. This stuff was locked away and buried. Then she hosts a follow-up meeting night, the spiritual salon. Oh my God, really? I remember thinking,
a forum for open-hearted discussion about sex, sexuality, and spirituality, alarms were going off for me. Can I even go to that? I'm the youth director. Can I even like be seen there? So silly, but I'm serious. These were the kind of the internal thoughts that would go on. My goodness, we're going to talk about this at church. I did go, and it was groundbreaking for me. Other classes along the way included the Playing Big book study for women supporting women in expression of their full truth, their true calling. I attended Healthy Boundaries with John, Maka, and Shane. I went to Intro to Metaphysics with Paul Hasselbeck. And then the Enneagram. Holy moly, life-changing to put it mildly. The Enneagram, as Ravnia teaches it, is a system of sacred psychology designed to help you identify your personality, or false self, which is your Enneagram type, represented by one of 9 points on a circle. So you can get beneath that veneer of personality and live from your true self, from your true wholeness, represented by the circle. So the first thing you do is you determine your type on this 9-point chart. I wanted to be a 2. I was like, oh, that's, yeah. The helper, yeah, that's me. That sounded like me. And then I found out I was a 7. No, I can't be a 7. I'm not kidding, I had an absolute crisis around this. The 7 is all about their own experience, the epicure, the adventurer. What? There was no denying that I was a 7, but at the same time, the descriptions would sometimes seem almost opposite to me. It didn't sound familiar. It sounded like the opposite of everything I've ever been, and yet I knew I was a 7, and sometimes it rang completely true. So what was going on? It did sound very familiar when they said that the 7s are focused on their sense of freedom. Hello. So, upon further study, it became clear that I'm a social subtype of the 7. This is considered the countertype, and when I read the following description, when I read it, it all made sense to me. The social 7. Sacrifice. This countertype acts against the gluttony that characterizes the 7, tending to mistype with Enneagram type 2. They are generous and have a strong desire to be of service to create a better world. They will sacrifice their own needs to serve the needs of a group or person that they support, and they can be judgmental regarding selfishness in themselves or others. And they hope to be appreciated for their sacrifice. Judgmental of selfishness, who, me? Through the Enneagram, I realized that nobody else my whole life was actually keeping me from expressing my true self. I was. In an attempt to project perfection to the world, I had denied myself freedom and repressed my wholeness in the process. A quote from Robert Johnson. It seems that it is the purpose of evolution now to replace an image of perfection with the concept of completeness or wholeness. Perfection suggests something all pure, with no blemishes, dark spots, or questionable areas. Wholeness includes the darkness, but combines it with the light elements into a totality more real and whole than any ideal. This is an awesome task, and the question for us is whether mankind is capable of this effort and growth. Ready or not, we are in that process. Like a beach ball held underwater, the more you try to submerge it, it will find a way to come to the surface. Aspects or elements of the repressed part of my true self would occasionally rise to the surface in a kind of rebellion. I knew something desperately needed to change. I still wasn't sure how this was going to happen, but it was happening. And I could tell I was going to be digging up and facing some difficult stuff. I felt more ready than ever to do so. So, before anything would really change, I first had to really, really get in touch with the parts that I had buried along the way. Couldn't do it by talking to other people, couldn't do it by reading books, or even going to classes. What
came next for me would be a kind of sacred compass. And after years scrambling from beach to beach, my weary soul was excited. From that Enneagram class, we flowed kind of just naturally into the CPE groups, Contemplative Practice and the Enneagram. This is a different kind of meeting class thing. This class includes 20 or more minutes of silence at the beginning. We also include then after that an hour and a half of truth-telling, sacred listening, holding space for each other. Trust is created through confidentiality, but even more importantly, the agreement not to try to fix one another, but to simply be present as a non-judging witness to our inner stories. I feel what Palmer describes in the book as circles of trust is what we've already been experiencing in these CPE groups. First, before I get into that, I want to share more of my understanding of the work that is mine to do as an Enneagram 7. So I've attended two retreats in Nebraska, hosted by Felina and Christopher Kuertz. Some other folks here went as well last fall. Christopher is the author of The Sacred Enneagram, now one of the primary books that Nian teaches from in her class on the subject. It's been awesome to share space with both of them and hear Chris speak specifically about the work of the seven. I didn't realize just how true it was for me that I'm never satisfied, always looking to the future in my crazy active mind. One term to describe seven, the frustrated idealist. Always about the possibilities, always having a positive outlook. And that's not all bad. I agree, to be idealistic and positive does have its place, but it's not always what's called for. And when unchecked, it can indicate an avoidance of dealing with real pain and present moment problems. Sevens want desperately to be free, but we are not free. Whenever we're tied up and addictively or compulsively seeking an escape from the perceived restriction of the present moment. Was I doing that? I didn't realize. My bad, maybe I was. In Chris's book, he basically prescribes for each of the nine types a particular intention to go into the silence, like a posture for your time in prayer and meditation. So for the seven, it is to rest in silence, rest your mind, those thoughts settle. At my retreat this March, Chris said, specifically, sevens, please stop looking to what's next. Be here with us now. Rest in silence. Return to presence. This is the work of the seven. It makes sense then why certain friends here would tease me about going on a retreat where I cannot speak for 40 hours, because that's what this spring was, a silent retreat. I knew intellectually about meditation. I knew I should meditate more, but it took having this CPE commitment before I really started a consistent practice. Incredible to note, really, the irony, the contrast. Choosing, consenting, to rest in silence. After so much searching out there for answers, to keep with the buried treasure analogy, it's as if I've been seeking along the sandy shoreline for this treasure, but I was actually resting deep on the ocean floor. Thinking about meditation, that was like, that's it. And I, and God, we are the ocean. As Nian taught at the Easter service, we're not just a wave on the ocean, we are the ocean. And that's what it feels like to go into this silence. In Nebraska, Chris and Felina described the centering prayer practice as excavating essence, about clearing space for divine love to flow in and through me. Surrender, allow. Create space. No expectation or criteria for success, just letting the silence do the work. I have to submit to the mystery, to let go Over and over, I catch myself thinking and trying, and I come back to that openness. It's an openness to the fullness of the presence of God within. I'm immersing myself in the mystery, trusting that the treasure is waiting. So in my meditation, I actually do use this imagery sometimes when my mind is super busy and active and trying to figure it all out. It's as if I'm splashing on the surface of a shallow water, making waves. It's frantic and busy and loud. But then I sink under the surface. I can breathe just fine. But I'm underwater now, where all of a sudden it's quiet. It's darker and quite peaceful. With each out-breath, I sink a few feet deeper. It gets a little darker. The silence pulls me deeper. This would have been so scary in the past, but it's not now. My tension melts away. I'm heavier and heavier as I sink. I'm out of my head and I'm in my body now, relaxed and just being in the moment, resting in silence. I see the buried treasure. It's been down here all along. I'm meeting myself just as I am, all the parts of me, and it's okay. Wow, imagine that, finding deeper connection, peace, and love. Freedom to be myself, within myself. Not in my outer experience and variety and adventure and nonstop excitement, but in the quiet emptiness of a single moment. From a place of freedom and wholeness, my soul, my essence, can be a complex contradiction. And I can welcome and include even those parts I don't like, embrace them into the list of fullness of who I am. Practicing wholeness to me means I am who I am, and I'm safe to show up, the imperfect me, because there's a belief that I will still have love, I will still be love, and I will still be plenty of safety and love for me. As I mentioned earlier, we can find encouragement in community like this one, CPE, and groups like Parker Palmer's Circle of Trust. This work takes courage, and I find great support and accountability from having fellow travelers on the journey. To go into silence and to come out and speak your truth. First, one of my favorite Brené Brown quotes, famous for her work on courage. It's long, I'm gonna skip it. But then this quote from Maya Angelou: without courage, we cannot practice any other virtue with consistency. We can't be kind, true, merciful, generous, or honest. It's brave to go into the empty space, empty ourselves, to go deep. The fear if we go sinking into nothingness, to the depths of our soul, what if it's truly empty? Well, the truth is it's actually full. Full of life, full of love, a love that never runs out. Full of more peace and joy and wisdom and abundance than we could ever need in 1,000 lifetimes. Our personal treasure chest of divine light. This is where I found my spiritual freedom. In the center of one's nothingness, one meets the infinitely real.